Now, we've got a lot to do today. If you'll look at your book and notice how much we've gone over, and go ahead and feel how much we haven't gone over, and we are officially in trouble, okay? So today, we're going to move. And I'd like for you to go right now to the meek, if you will. In the eyes of the world, the meek top the list of those least likely to succeed. Now, you remember this as one of the Beatitudes. I really like the Beatitude, the poor in spirit. I think that sets up everything else in your life. But there's some other people that thought this was the Beatitude that really is consequential, and John Wesley happened to be one of those guys. In fact, saints of every age have found Wesley's center to be pretty profound. That is, there's no disposition which is more essential to Christianity. So if we're to understand this Beatitude, it's crucial to examine it against the backdrop of Jesus' culture. So we've already suggested some of this. Let's keep moving and just fill in some blanks around it. The Greek word for meek was commonly used to describe wild animals that had been domesticated, trained, tamed, and otherwise harnessed so that the savage beast became capable of working profitably alongside of him. The image that presents itself in this definition is not lack of energy or strength, rather, it's power under control. So Gerald Mann illustrates his insight with a story from Greek antiquity of a young soldier writing to his sweetheart. It's during the Peloponnesian Wars, actually, and he says this: "He is the most magnificent animal I've ever seen. But he responds obediently to the slightest command. He allows his master to direct him to his full potential. He is truly a meek horse." Just a little tug over here, a little tug over there, slightest command, this meek animal is willing to do whatever. So, kind of interesting here, I actually went to a horse trainer in Texas, and I asked this horse trainer, describe to me exactly what we're talking about when we're talking about a meek horse or a gentle horse. And they had already turned gentle, but she understood the meek too. So I asked, what's going on here? She says, first off, it's power under control. Once broken, she said, a good horse doesn't require much correction. He has learned to accept the reins of his master. Gentle tug is all that's needed to urge him one direction or the other. The process does not remove the power, does not remove the life, or remove the verb used to make the animal. Rather, it takes the energy, the wildness, under control. So that phrase, channel their spirit, is commonly used to describe this process. When you channel that spirit, horse is generally able to jump higher, run faster, even work harder than the uncontrolled animal. Second of all, she said, learn the master's mind. A special relationship develops between horse and trainer. After years of working together, they develop a rapport that becomes second nature to both of them. Thus trained, a good horse can sense a bad rider and will resist false guidance. An intimate kinship evolves, and it's not long before the horse acts according to what it knows the master would do, even if the master does not give explicit instructions. So, I got a quick little thing here for you. Again, not a real man here, okay? So I don't do man things, and I don't ride horses. I like animals. I can take swipes at dogs and cats because I don't like them to begin with, okay? It's easy for me to do that. Some of you are wincing, not me. Don't like them. And by the way, my name is Matt, not Matthew, and I was named for Matt Dillon. Now, does that ring a bell?
Gunsmoke.
You know, Gunsmoke, Dodge City, Kansas. Rawhide law enforcement, right?
Yeah.
So that's my destiny. That's what I'm supposed to be, but I'm not that. My sister one day said, let's go to Colorado. I want you to chaperone our youth. We're going to take a youth trip to Colorado. Kansas every year empties out to Colorado. Kansas is a relatively boring place. It's wheat fields and oil pumps, all right? And so when harvest is done, we just all go, everybody just picks up and goes to Colorado. So it's time to go to Colorado. Youth group's going to Colorado. Need you for to be a chaperone. I go. Then one day she says, okay, we're going horseback riding. I said, you know, I'll just stay back here and read the Bible. Well, I'll tell you what, I'll be the next speaker and I'll kind of get the message ready to go. She goes, no. Come on. Need for you to come. So I go and I'm sitting there and there's a lady named Grandma, and she's working at this sort of dude ranch thing, and then there's Grandpa's back there getting the horses. So Grandma looks at Joe, says, Joe's, you know, kind of medium build. Let's get a medium build horse. Bring out, you know, Betty or whatever. So Betty come out. Joe gets on Betty, and he rides off, and everybody kind of just starts getting in a line. And I'm back there just trying to duck behind, you know, see if I can, you know, I got to go to the restroom now, whatever. And finally, they see me, and my sister Lisa, who really doesn't like me very much, says, oh, there's Matt. He wants to go horseback riding. I said, no, really. Out of horses, don't even know. I'm fine. I'll just stay here. I'll read my Bible, right? Grandma says, oh, look at him. He's a big un. And since she looks over Grandpa, we got a big un here. Get Igor. Now, I'm wanting Betty right now, okay? I say, Igor? What's an Igor? And out comes this, you know them beer horses? You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. What they call Clydesdales? Yeah. Yeah. This thing makes Clydesdale look like a little Betty thing. I mean, I'm all of a sudden riding an elephant, you know, that looks like a horse. It's huge. And in my most embarrassing moment as a man, all right, is I can't figure out how to get on the thing, all right? It's got a, what do they call them, stirrups or whatever, you know? But the thing's so high, the stirrup's like right there, I can't figure out. And I'm not, because I'm a weightlifter, Troy, I don't have much, you know, so I can't, so here I am finally in my worst moment as a man. Grandma has actually bent over like this. So I'm putting my foot in the middle of a 75-year-old woman's back, getting on the Eagle. It's horrible. So I'm on. So we go on a ride. And about 500 yards into it, I'm starting thinking, you know, Matt Dillon thoughts. This is okay, I can do this. Then I start thinking, I'm pretty good at this. Then I think, this is my destiny. This is what I was meant to do, right? And I'm feeling kind of cocky about the whole thing. So, we get to a fork of the road, and all the kids go this way. And I'm back a little ways because I don't want to be seen. If someone sees me, I don't want to be seen with a youth group, you know. Because I'm Matt Dillon from Dodge City, Kansas. So I'm back a little ways, kind of. So all the kids go this way, fork in the road, and I say, we're going that way. So they told us what to do. If you want a horse to go a particular direction, you pull the reins that direction, but pull the head over here, and then kick it and say something. And I'm thinking, I think I know what you're supposed to say. Ha! All right, so pull the head. Ha! And Igor's head goes like this, then goes right back. Right? I'm thinking, that didn't work. Let me try that again. So I get both hands. Jerk it a little heavier. Kick it a little harder and go, ha! And head goes over, head goes right back. Let me try that one more time here. And I'm mad now because, you know, he's not doing what Matt Dillon wants it to do, all right? Ha! All right? He's not going to go the way I want it to go. I'm thinking, this ain't a good horse. Because a good horse is supposed to do what the master wants it to do. And we finally go with the rest of the youth, all right? And then it all of a sudden dawns on me. I ain't the master. Grandma was the trainer. Grandma's the master. And Grandma said to this horse, however you talk to horses, Igor, someday, this is going to be some idiot from Kansas that's going to be on you. And he's going to kick you in the side, he's going to twist your head over, and he's going to yell at you to go this direction. And no matter how many times he does that, you go that direction. Because I wasn't the master. Grandma was the master. Anybody ever been kicked? And told to go a certain direction and yelled at? And you did it based on, you got yelled at, you got kicked. And yeah, guess what? The life of the early Christians were very much, do this or you're going to get kicked. yelled at, punished, crucified. And you got to decide who's your master. It's kind of like the head nodders, right? You've got to decide who's my head nodder. Who am I taking my cues from? And that's what a meek horse eventually does, and that's what meek people do. We remember who the master is, and we obey their slightest command.